Again, we are studying the parables of Christ, which were just his lessons. The parables, if you will, were Jesus' lesson plan. That was his curriculum. Amen. While he was on earth, to teach those. The parables were taught to Christians and to non-Christians. Because in standing nearby, anywhere Jesus went, there was a crowd, there was a following. Believers and non-believers. And the amazing thing about the parables is that he taught them in a way that taught the disciples or the believers, and in which also taught the non-believers, or it captured their attention. It gave them something to gnaw on, if you will. If you'll turn to Matthew 6, excuse my voice this morning.
Some water?
Maybe, please. Matthew 6, starting at the 25th verse. And again, we're actually coming in on some parables in the middle, at the end, at the beginning, and they are nestled in other parables, and that's because we're just dealing with the ones on nature right now. Nature testifies of who God is.
Amen.
Because nature acts in the place that it was created to be. We were watching this thing, I think it was on the Discovery Channel or something like that one time, maybe Animal Planet, and this bird had gotten this like walnut or this nut or something, and he would get it in his beak and he would crush it against the rock to get it open. And, you know, and my first thought was, how does he know to do that? And I thought, well, duh, the Father speaks to him. The Father trains him. You know, what science teachers call instinct is really God-created ability to survive. Thank you very much. Somebody once said that God created the world and then he put it on autopilot. And there is some truth in that. When you watch animals and when animals, if you've ever watched a cat or a dog give birth, how they know to take care of the umbilical cord, all the parts that go with birth, and then how they know how to start cleaning around the mouth and nose first, just like your doctor suctioned your baby's nose, ladies, when you were born, mother kittens will lick their kitten's face first. How do they know to do that? Because they are created by God. So instinct is, they are created to be what the Father created them to be. Amen. And they live that. Where we humans get in trouble is, unlike animals, we second guess everything we already know. Shelby, when she was little, used to say, she would tell me she had done something. And I would, say, well, I'm glad you told me. And she said, well, I felt it in my feel bads. That was what she used to say. I felt it in my feel bads. That is what we were created to be, that inner conscience. All our conscience is, it's not an answer to ourselves. It's an answer to God. And so when we talk about a guilty conscience, that is because the created part of us is that was born and created and purposed to serve God is fighting against the flesh that we control and think. That we think and control. So the only people that get in trouble with lack of instinct is us, and it's not lack of instinct, it's that we war against it. Because we want what we want, not what that inner feel bad, and I don't want to call it feel bad there, but you understand what I'm saying, that conscience that God put in us, that spiritual check, if you will, that we are out of order or we are out of line. Matthew 6, starting at the 25th verse. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? it's funny because especially if you watch teenagers. I used to have, and it's not just girls. I used to, in school, I had a friend named Jeff, and he was a wrestler. He was a high school wrestler for our team there. And he would go certain days without eating any lunch because he had to make his weight. He had to come in at a certain weight in order to wrestle in a certain match. Girls, as soon as spring, like, you know, 2 weeks before spring break, they quit eating so they can wear a bathing suit. And our lives will start to center around food. And we see that. Or clothing. You know, clothing. Some people have an issue with clothing. And it's all ways that we use to make ourselves feel good. Ladies, ever been upset and go out and buy something you really didn't want, really couldn't afford, really didn't need, but it made you feel better?
Amen.
Same thing with eat.
And then it just hangs in the closet.
Exactly. I have bought things before, and you don't even really realize you're doing it. There's just this high after it, that you've got yourself something nice, something new. After all, we work for a living, right? And then I'll go back later and look in the closet and go, why did I like that so well? So what I started doing is I started training myself, if I thought I really, really wanted something, to walk off from it. And if 3 days later I'm still thinking about it, then I might go back and get it. because we are impulsive. We're very impulsive. And we like immediate satisfaction, immediate feel goods. We are a microwave society. I was speaking with a parent the other day in a conference that I had asked them to come in and talk with me. And she said to me, I don't know what to do with him. She said, we're trying so hard. She said, he's a smart kid. And she said, he's a good kid. But it seemed like as he's getting older, he's starting to take the easy road. He doesn't, you know, school's too hard, so he wants us to move him to a different school. It's too hard here. He wants to go somewhere else where it's the classes aren't so hard. And, you know, he wants to do this, and he wants to go here instead of being with us because there's no rules there and it's easier there. How do I get the point across to him that the harder road is sometimes the best road or is the better road? And I said, I don't know what to tell you because I will still stop at McDonald's and feed my kids instead of going home to cook. Because it's our human nature, even as adults. And we sometimes look at the young kids and we say, you know, they don't do this and they don't do that. If we really kind of hush up and kind of look a little in the mirror, we would realize that we're really not a whole lot different than they are. You know, I remember one time that I got on Shelby and Josie. Those of you that remember the Parsonage before it was remodeled, that was close to 20 years ago, there was a breakfast bar that come out from one wall. And Josie and Shelby were sitting there before school one morning, and they were bickering. And I said, would you two stop? I said, you're supposed to love each other. You're fussing over nothing. And one of them, I don't remember which one it was, I'm sure it was probably Shelby, knowing the character of my two, said, you and Daddy do it. Now, our flesh, what some of us moms would do, and probably have done before, I didn't that morning, would say, what your father and I do is none of your business. We are adults.
Yeah.
That's what we do, right? Because we don't want to, we justify ourselves so that we don't, you know, have to admit we just got owned by a seven-year-old. But it's true. And so Jesus, when he was speaking to us about it's so much more than just food or clothing or faith and trusting him, he was speaking to our very nature. And our nature is if we amass these things to ourselves, we feel like we feel good. Do we not think that after we get a promotion or we get some good news, we got another baby on the way, or someone's we or you know, somebody gets engaged, or what's the first thing we do? Well, let's make reservations at a nice restaurant that we normally wouldn't pay that much for. But let's celebrate, we deserve it. And so by human nature, we are very we're very prone to making our flesh feel good. And that's how we feel successful. That's how we feel like we have arrived. That's how we feel like... I remember Scott saying one time that he remembers when he could buy his lunch out instead of taking a brown bag, that he felt like he had accomplished something. And it is. It's our human nature to think that if we can cater to the physical needs of the body, that we are successful. And Jesus was basically telling us here, he was talking about so much more than clothing and food and raiment. He was talking about where our hearts are. He was so much deeper here than just surface things that we need. What he was saying is those things, you know, clothing's going to burn up. You know, how I dropped off 3 bags of clothing yesterday to one of the boxes, and 2 of them had been passed to me from somebody else, and 1 of them passed to somebody, and then to me. And every one of those things probably represented somebody in somewhere buying something to make themselves feel good, and they might have worn it one time before it went in the bag to go to somebody else. And I said all that to say this. Clothing will rot away. I remember years ago, we had this dear little lady named Sister Smith. And she would, I don't know, Scott, what would you say? She was already in her 70s, close to 80 when we got saved. And I remember, I don't even remember what started the conversation with her. Dear, sweet little lady. And Josie and Shelby were little, and I was fussing at them or something, and she just reached around across the pew and patted my leg, and she said, honey, she said, them babies aren't going to be babies long. And that led us into a conversation, and I'm talking about a messy house and toys everywhere and trying to get the kids out the door without getting dirty and all that. And she said to me, she said, let me tell you something, if I ever teach you anything, she said, when mine were little, said we worked so hard to make sure they had nice clothing and nice shoes. And she said, and I fretted and fussed about the house being clean. And she said, you know, now, and at that time she had already buried some of her children. She had outlived some of her children. And she said to me, she said, and you know what? Every shoe that I bought represented hours spent away from my children working. And those shoes are rotted away somewhere. She said, but the things that I instilled in my children, like the love of Christ and raising your family in godly admonition, she said, those things will last for all eternity. I realize that you need to buy them shoes. She said, I realize that. She said, but I spent entirely too much time giving them the best instead of giving them what they needed, when the best would have been what they needed plus me. And Paul said, if we could learn to be content. Remember what he said? Naked I came into the world. Naked I'll go out. And I've learned to be content. And so when Jesus was saying, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, not yet for your body, what you shall put on, is not the life more than meat and the body than raiment? He wasn't just talking about having faith that you're going to have a meal tomorrow. What he was saying is we've got to get this thing right in here. The importance of life. The importance of time. Scott's mother used to have a plaque that said, help me because I don't know if I can quite it. Okay. Only one life will soon be passed, and only what's done for Christ will last. And so what Jesus was saying is, why worry about all these things? He's already got that taken care of. Verse 26, behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Not a care in the world. Scott and I were coming home We had gone, we had driven to Zephyr Hills yesterday to buy a bigger crate for my monster of a dog. And as we were coming back, it was just a beautiful day, and we had the sunroof open and the windows down, and you know, and we looked and Scott said, "Look at that bird." And it had just caught a wind. It had caught this airstream, and it was dipping, and it was just you could tell it was just enjoying itself. And I thought about, you know, this parable that we're gonna be going over today. That bird didn't have a care in the world. And then as it got closer to us and we saw it out through the sunroof, it had something to eat in its claws. So not only was it just having a good old time, you know, its dinner was already prepared for it. And just carefree. Go ahead, Brian.
I was just going to say that, you know, God equips us to do the same thing, to catch a wind and to float and to not have to be concerned about those things. But we get so caught up in the material things of this life that we find ourselves extended further than we should be. And instead of being able to enjoy the float of that wind, you know, we're constantly concerned about the next wind to keep me afloat.
Right.
Because we've overextended ourselves and we haven't, you know, done what we should do. Mm-hmm. And that's live within your means. You know, God, we get so caught up in the Joneses, and Dave Ramsey is so big about that, you know, live like no one else now.
I can't give to the church because I can't afford it.
That's right. Because I have to pay my credit card bill because of all the stuff that I bought to keep up with the Joneses.
Some of it that I don't even have anymore.
Right.
This one thing I learned about credit cards after three times of paying them off before we finally learned. And that was that the credit card bill lasted way longer after the item went kaput.
Amen.
That's sure did. Yes, sir.
You alluded to this scripture a minute ago, and I was just contemplating. I said, Paul said, godliness with contentment is great
gain.
That's right.
And
yeah.
All I was equating to is our house down in Florida here is very small, and we still had company over there. There was so much love we had that even though we're packed in this little house, mm-hmm. the bathroom's probably 5x7. Mm-hmm. I mean, and you picture getting ready in a bathroom that small.
Yeah, we have one like that Pinellas Park.
But that's the only bathroom we have. And we got like a quarter bathroom. Mm-hmm. I built this little place where the water heater is. At least there's another toilet, because and you got 8 people in the house.
Yeah.
And it's the middle of the night and somebody's in the bathroom. I sneak outside into my beach bathroom. Mm-hmm. Next to the water heater. But we got this house in Martinsville that's like 3,500 square feet. We got a deck going over a big ravine. We got the corner lot. I got a second garage full of stuff. I got my painting trailer. I got my RVs. And you know, when I'm down here in Florida, I think about this every day. I don't miss anything that's mm-hmm. there. I mean, if something happened and all that just went away, and I still had my little house here, I'm in the geographical location where God's called me to be.
Right.
And that's my content.
Walking
in. And to hear God tell me, you're making a difference. You know, I'm sitting in my chair the other night, my kind of broken down chair from Salvation Army. I'm not sitting in my nice luxury leather chair like I got home. And I have contentment.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I don't have to have my 70-inch big screen. I got my little thing there.
You don't have to shovel snow.
Don't
shut up. So you're going to stay here all year, right?
Ice your roads, no put chains on your tires.
No house payment. I mean, I'm talking about
it. Amen.
I go out in the front yard and get a few stickers on my feet, so what? You know?
Yeah.
I don't have the nice pavers and the nice stuff that everybody has.
Really,
and I am in heaven. I am literally in heaven.
Right.
And I'm relating to what you're saying.
Yeah. You know, it's so funny that all of the modern conveniences, we're entrapped. We are slaves mm-hmm. to the modern conveniences that were meant to free us up. Mm-hmm. You know, we get a DVR so that we don't have to, so that we can go out and enjoy our life, and we have to rush home to set it to capture what's...
With Brian, you can
program
from your phone.
Oh, there you go. From your phone. So, instead of driving and paying attention to what you're doing, you're setting your DVR at home to watch something you probably shouldn't be watching in the first place.
Making trash.
You know? Microwaves. Why is it that 3 microwave minutes is longer than 10 football minutes?
Uh-oh.
You ever stood in front of a microwave for 3 minutes? That is the longest 3 minutes ever. Cell phones. You know what? I was talking to Shiloh last night, and we were just talking about chocolate and stuff like that, and I was telling her about, now some of you, you have to probably be over 40 to remember what these were. Remember the chocolate things called AIDS? They were diet AIDS, and they were like chocolate caramels, and they were supposed to be appetite suppressants. Anybody remember those?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like X-Lax?
Kind of. So when I said last night to Shiloh, I was telling her about, and I said AIDS, she went, there was a diet help called AIDS? That's kind of, and it dawned on me that she's never had a lifetime where there was no HIV or AIDS. So when I said AIDS, as in a diet aid, her mind went to disease. And she said, why would they name it that? And I said, well, that was before AIDS. And she went, I said, they didn't discover AIDS until I was a senior in high, or maybe in high school, which was the mid-80s.
Right.
And it put me in that mindset of life before certain things. I remember when the neighbor's kids had a VCR and we didn't, because we didn't have the $800 for one. $800. Anybody remember the $800 VCRs? And they were as big as the top of your TV, and they rewound as slowly as they played. So you bought a separate rewinder that went shh, and you would sit and watch it. I remember 2 channels on the TV. You had the, what was it, the UHF and the VHF. And one you got channel like 32 on, and one you got channel 2. So you could get Hee Haw or Lawrence Welk. And then I remember going out on the side of the house with the window opening, turning the antenna to get one of those 2 with my grandmother hauling, right there, right there. I'm only 45. I'm only 45. And now you can set your TV from your phone. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think about...
Now we have phones.
Yeah. You know what? I thought, when I call one of my children, see, there is a major, major breaking of the commandments. Mm-hmm. When I pay for your cell phone and you don't answer it when I call.
That's a major
malfunctioning of the rule system.
Amen.
In my house.
Amen.
Okay?
That's awesome.
And I think when my children are elsewhere, and you know, because your children are never safe, you know, we forget that God's watching over them. And so in our mom mentalities, dads probably aren't as bad about this. In mom mentality, if your children are not with you, they are unsafe. No matter how much you trust the people they are with, even if they're with their father. You know that he's got them out on a tree 40 feet above the water with a fishing pole. That's tooth going to jerk them right in the water, and he's not going to find them, and that's the stuff that goes through your mind. And I think about that, and I think, I'm a slave to worry when my children don't answer their phone. What in the world must my mother have gone through? When there was only a house phone, and if somebody was on it, it said, Remember, anybody remember when they introduced call waiting?
Oh. Yeah.
I do.
Blushing.
You see, and so these things that wrap up our lives, call waiting was supposed to be more convenient. Well, I remember when they went from the party line to private lines.
Oh, yes.
That was supposed to be more convenient. Well, it was really hard to listen to all the ladies in the town chatter with a private line. I remember when I went to private line, I said, because I used to be able, when I was a kid, be able to listen to all them ladies gossip. But all those things that are meant to give us more convenience. So instead of being tied up on the phone with one person, oh, hold on, I got another call coming. You talk about rude. Let me put you aside, because who's calling might be more important. And so then we got, oh, okay, yeah, well, let me go back and tell her to hang up because this is probably more important than that. So then instead of being busy with one person on the phone, then we're busy with two people on the phone while we're standing in front of the microwave. And so what Jesus was telling us is not, he's not trying to tell us about, don't worry about eating and drinking and having nice clothes. He was saying, your focus. We heap all these things to our flesh. All these things that are modern day feel goods. Got to sit in the doctor's office for a problem? No problem. I've been trying to beat level 73 on Candy Crush for about a month now. Makes the waiting easier. Doesn't bother you at all to wait for an hour until your phone goes dead. Then you're like, I've been here an hour. And so Jesus was saying, consider the other things that I have created. They don't hustle and bustle about. They take care of their needs, their basic needs. They take care of their young. They do what they're supposed to do. They live in their purpose. Bees are supposed to make honey. That's what they do. They're supposed to pollinate things so that we can have fruit and vegetables and honey. And they just do what, you know, what they're supposed to do. Verse 27, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? In other words, there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do about it. And usually when we attempt to do something about it, we mess it up. Ever tried to fix anything and you make it worse than it started being? Verse 28, and why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And, you know, and I always wondered what this spin meant, you know. And I haven't looked it up in the Greek and got all, you know, philosophical and everything on you or got real deep on you. But what I think it means is they don't toil. They're not working themselves into an early grave. And neither do they spin about in a frenzy worrying about how they're going to take care of this next thing in front of them. You remember the old black and white movies where the women would get hysterical and they'd get frantic and then you'd see her husband, you would usually slap her. You can't put that on TV anymore. But you remember those movies and stuff like that where she would just get frantic? And do you know where the word hysterectomy comes from?
Hysterical. Oh, man.
It's where it comes from. That's where it comes from. It was when women would start to get older and they would go through all the hormonal changes and they were said to be in a state of hysteria when they took all the female parts out. That was called a hysterectomy. Because we spin and we frenzy and we frantic ourselves into a worried mess to make sure, got to pick up those extra hours at work. Got it. I've watched one of my family members use one credit card to make a payment on another. Or cash advance on one to pay a car insurance. While the nails are done every 3 weeks and the Starbucks are always held between the nails. Scott?
I've always looked at the spin part as like the loom, as far as the work that was very common in that day was the wool, and you have to spin it into a garment. You see what I'm saying? So work, yeah, or labor of your hands, they don't toil or spin.
It's good thought to, yeah. Yeah.
And so you think of the flowers, they don't even have to make themselves clothes.
Right, they're clothed. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but look at this other, we worry about it. Mm-hmm. We don't have,
right, well,
too much.
And God, clothing wasn't God's idea. Mm-hmm. If you hear Shiloh tell it, it was Eve eating the chocolate covered pomegranates. Shiloh was eating chocolate covered pomegranates, and she said, "I am pretty sure this is why Eve sold out all of mankind." But remember that? Remember that? It wasn't even, what was it? Eve ate to make herself feel good. And that's how raiment come into play. Because there was no need for it. Because all they had to do was stroll through a garden. Sounds like a fantasy, doesn't it? Fantasy world. Stroll through a garden and pat the tigers on the head. That's all they had to do. Could you imagine? I love animals. I could imagine just laying out in the hammock, you know, fussing at the cheetahs to hush so I can take a nap. You know?
Never having to work for food.
Never having to work for food. Walk up and, you know. And wasn't that true? I'm glad you brought that up, speaking of Adam and Eve. He is saying focus on what you do have instead of what you don't have. And that's what where you got in trouble. He said, of all this, you can partake freely. But this one tree, leave it alone. What tree? What's so good about that tree?
The cookie jar.
That one tree? And I heard somebody say one time, if they were eating properly of what God had been providing of all the good trees, she would have been so full that Satan wouldn't even have been able to speak to her. She just said, I'm too hungry to have another bite. I'm too full to even take a bite of that. I'm so full of God's goodness, I can't take another bite right now.
Shelly, I think that, you know, I don't think I know that the Lord is waiting for us to be so dependent on Him that not to stress about anything. I mean, we do our part, of course. We work, we do what we know to do. We don't just lay back and say, you know, give me everything. And I know for my own life, I just learn every day that, you know, when something comes in the mail, like just something came a few days ago that our insurance was changed for the house down here without we opted out of a claim that was taking us to another insurance company. And I did like 3 different calls and verified and make sure, you know. And then I get this packet, like 100 pages, this is your new insurance company. And I thought, of course it comes right before the weekend, right? Friday. And of course everything is closed. So it's like I had a choice whether to let that ruin my whole weekend, thinking, oh my goodness, what has happened here? And but you know, I just resting in Him and realizing, and then come to find out it was just an error, it's going to be taken care of, you know?
Right.
But the bottom line for me is just to rest in Him, and the things I can't change, I can't change that. Things are going on back home. There's all kinds of crazy stuff going on back home in Indiana there. But I have to make a choice. Am I just going to allow the Lord just to take care of it because I can't do anything about it from 1,000 miles away?
Mm-hmm.
Or am I just going to wring my hands and ruin my time?
Mm-hmm. And frenzy, right. Yeah. What's up in a frenzy?
And that would be my nature to do that.
Right.
So I have to make a choice.
You know, the funny thing is when it comes to provision, our bills, our things like that, I watched another family member of ours run up credit cards on stuff that is not needed. Second mortgage of the home on, and then take it on trips and do stuff like this and just buy, 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 buy. And then say, I know the Lord's going to give me a blessing and pay off my credit cards. And that's not what He meant by provision. Our problem, the reason we do not prosper financially is because we hold on to too much.
That's right.
If we gave it away, the Lord would pour us out a blessing that we couldn't contain. Now, either you believe His word or you don't. That's not my word, that's His. And so C.S. Lewis said in Mere Christianity, he said, our problem comes in here. That we can't give to the church because we do too many other things. He said, imagine what your life would be like if you couldn't do other things because you gave too much to the church. Now, he wasn't saying you have to live the life of a poor martyr because you give to the church, but he understood the principle and the ability of God that where if you gave it all, God would give you more.
That's right.
He can't pour, you can't pour any more tea into a cup that the tea has not been poured out of. So when we do not give, we shut up the windows of heaven.
Mm.
So if, I'm just be careful there.
Preach it.
If you're not getting, it could be because you're not giving.
Amen.
And I understand that could be taken as a harsh word. But if you have issue with it, take it up with the author.
True.
I'm just reading you parts of the text. Brother Bud?
Yeah, James, he's where it says light is put away from the sin, vanisheth away. God has given us an entire instruction book on how to spend your time wisely and invest it. And since he is the author and owner of time, he can give you more time. That's the only place you'll get more time is from God. Once you spend it, you cannot get it back. It is the most precious commodity we have. And I learned some lessons through my kids and through Musk's kids. Give a $100 electronic toy to go get lost and go play in our room, and they want your time, they want you. They'd rather you sit down there with them in a $2 toy and put your time directly in front of them.
Amen.
You can sit in the floor with a kid in a cardboard box, mm-hmm. and they'll have if they're your attention.
Amen.
There's just no way. I remember, you can't outgive God. Scott, correct me if I'm telling this story wrong. It's been a long time since I heard. I don't remember if it was Brother Murray or Brother Coulter went to an assembly one year, and they were taking up a mission offering. It was Brother Coulter. They were taking up a mission offering, and they had driven from another state, he and his wife, and he tells his wife, I'm going to give the car. And she immediately, well, how are we going to get home? You know, and I don't bust her chops for that because I was in the same thing. And you would have too. Because if God didn't, if God moved on his heart. He was trying to move on hers, but she wasn't buying it just yet. Okay? And he said, we'll get home. She said, we drove here. He put the pink slip of the car. He gave the car to the offering. The congregation, and when I say congregation, they were like a general assembly, so I don't know how many thousands of people, were so moved that he had given the pink slip to his 3 or 4 year old car that he went home in a new one that they all pitched in on. Am I telling that story right?
Almost.
What part did I tell wrong?
There was such an abundance of a response to the offering that they gave him back.
Oh, is that what? Oh, okay. All right. They gave him back his car. Okay. But what an amazing. He was prepared to walk home. He was prepared to walk home.
But you better hear from God before you do that.
Yeah.
Make sure it's like yourself.
So, yeah, make sure you hear from God. Otherwise, you'll be walking home. Verse 20, and you might walk home anyway.
Yeah.
You might walk home anyway. But I have no doubt that you won't be walking long.
Yeah.
You might get a new motorcycle or something. Less gas.
Should I tell my story? Can I tell you something, Scott?
Is it
true? When this happened, I sent a Facebook message to Pastor Scott because I couldn't believe it. All right. My husband and I recently joined this church, right? And after, 6 months, dragging our feet, attending, and all this. So, we've never tithed. I didn't know much about tithing. Sorry if I didn't. So, Pastor Scott, during the new member meeting, you know, how do I do this? What do I do? And he told me his take on it. So I said, okay, you know, we're going to do it. And my husband, who fights me on just about everything, I said, we need a time. I love him. He'll be here in a minute. Anyway. So I said, we need to tithe. I really feel like we need to tithe. We need to do our 10%, you know, whatever we need to do. And he's like, oh my gosh, how are we gonna? And I said, we're just gonna do it. We're just gonna do it.
Amen.
So I did it. Okay, listen, I did it, right? And my check bounced. Although it didn't bounce, it paid, the bank paid it, but I forgot my mortgage was due at the same time that I wrote that check. But it didn't matter. If they forgave me, I'd never done that before. So I got a letter in the mail. My husband and I have preschool, and we have like $1.5 million mortgage on this thing. Okay, it's new, it's 4 years old, and time will pay it off. We pay it ahead of time. So we've had it done in 10 years. But I got a letter in the mail saying that when we did our mortgage, that it was a variable rate. Okay, well, I thought the letter was saying, because it said, you know, 1.5% of a subprime, 2.5% of a subprime. And I was like, oh my gosh, our rate just went up, our mortgage just went up, oh my gosh. So I called the bank in a panic, and they said, no, your rate went down from 5.75% down to 4%. Wow. That's an extra $1,765 a month that you would pay. Praise God. That is money. I went to God, and I said, not only is my tax check going to be what it was, but I'm going to get to add 10% of that.
You know, it's like nobody will ever convince me of anything different. And I'm sure you'll never be convinced again, ever. And so, you know, it's just turning loose of it. Turning loose of it. Verse 29. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now remember how wealthy Solomon was? Okay?
How much he thought he was.
The richest man in the world at the time. And it said that he was not like this little lily in the field. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven. And you think about that. The you know, he clothes the grass of the field. We could get real poetic and go off into something totally different there for just a moment, but that's just one of those things that I think God blesses us with. When you drive down on the interstate and you look over and there's a field full of wildflowers. Now, of course, they serve a purpose. The bees use the pollen to pollinate the fruits and vegetables, and if you know anything about science, you understand all that, but they don't have to be so beautiful. Why did he make them that way? To remind us that there is a God in heaven that clothes even the grass of the field beautifully. Because without color and without petals and without beauty, the bees would still do what they're supposed to do. You know, science taught you that the reason flowers was pretty was to attract the bee. Bees would go where God told them to go without any physical beauty whatsoever. We don't even know how a bee sees, really. I mean, we put the charts up and assume that we know from tests and... So even in his provision, nature and beauty itself is just there for us to enjoy. Which today is, and tomorrow is cast in the oven, just like those shoes that Sister Smith talked about. One day, you know, flowers bloom, they die. They bloom, they die. They serve a purpose while they're there. Shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? And it says, for after all these things do the Gentiles seek. And we do. That we spend our entire life seeking after the things that he just talked about.
On Pinterest.
Yeah, on Pinterest. Amazon. The
us in that?
84,000 a second.
Amazon.
Per minute.
No problem, Amazon. Scott's grandmother told a story one time to us. This was his mother's mother. And his mom had moved in with her to take care of her as she had gotten older and feeble. And she told Scott's mom, she said, Tony, well, she called her Antonia. She called her by her mama name, her that she gave her. Antonia, she said, you remember that such and such family? And they hadn't seen them in a long time. I guess they used to attend their church or something. And said, the Lord's told me to take them some groceries. Now, she didn't drive. So she was letting Tony know so that Tony could go to the grocery and get the stuff and then put her in the car and take her over there to see this family that they hadn't seen in a long, long time. And she said, I've got a grocery list here that I made up. She said, I've been working on it. And she said, I want you to go get these groceries for me. And she said, now, I put the brand names in because the Lord told me not only what type of cereal, but what brand. Not, I don't want just chocolate cookies. I want Oreos or whatever it was. I don't know what the brands were, but that was. And she wrote down even the brand names of the things that she wanted. Well, it took them about 2 weeks to get this whole thing put together. So she loads Mama Bodner up in the car. She loads all these groceries up in the car, and off they go to this family's house. They knock on the door. They open the door, and they kind of come in to visit, and Mama starts talking to them. Mama Bodner starts telling them about these groceries, and they bring them in, and the mom goes to cry and saying that her husband and their two children were getting ready to split a can of peas for supper. And Mama went to crying and apologizing, saying, I am so sorry. The Lord gave me this list 2 weeks ago, and I just didn't get it done. And she said, oh, Sister Bodner, we had plenty 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, the kids in the background are going, oh, Oreo's my favorite. And you can hear the kids from the back pulling the groceries out, talking about their favorite cereal, their favorite cookies. So God didn't just bless them with provision. He provided brand names. And he also knew how long it would take Mama Creasy to get her feet moving and get the groceries there. So before they were ever hungry, their groceries were set to be delivered. Now that's not something we read about in Guidepost. I've heard his grandmother tell that story many times. Mm-hmm. And she wasn't a liar. I know her. I knew her. And she, you know. Verse 32, for after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things 2 weeks before you even know. From the foundation of the world as we know it. There is no time frame. God does not know time. He is not time. He is eternity. Your groceries have been set to be on your table before the world was even formed.
Amen.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. When they threw the three Hebrew children in, they said what? He'll deliver us. And even if he doesn't, we will not bow. In other words, he's going to show up. But just in case I'm wrong on that one because he has a different plan, I still will not give in or bow to an untruth. I will serve the truth. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. We're going to leave that there. We'll pick that back up next week with just a couple more on nature. If you would, make sure, we may have a lot of guests this morning. Please make sure that nobody walks in this building without having their hands shook or a good morning set.